everyone. Welcome back to my channel. Welcome back to another video. And today I am so excited because after what feels like forever, part one of Dove Cameron's debut album is finally here. Now, I have been a fan of Dove Cameron literally since Livin' Maddie. I saw her in that program and I fell in love with her. We are the same age. She's 2 months younger than me. So like, I just always really liked her as a person, and as we grew older together, the more I fell in love with her. The reason I watched Descendants was because she was in it. I just think she's wonderful, and I have followed her throughout her career, and I'm just so excited for this new chapter and her musical journey with her releasing the first half of the Alchemical album, which is just so exciting. I've been on this journey with her ever since she released music with her ex-fiance Ryan McCartan under the band name of The Girl and the Dreamcatcher. I still have that EP on my phone because I bought it off iTunes when it came out because I wanted to support them. It's great. Those songs are still so good. Cry Wolf is still one of my like favorite songs, and I know that Dove, obviously considering that relationship ended quite badly. The relationship was quite bad while it was together and it ended quite badly, has distanced herself from that music now, but I still really enjoy it. It's really good. And then she went in to have a solo career and she released a bunch of singles, which unfortunately are no longer available on streaming services. She had Bloodshot, Waste, Out of Touch, Remember Me, We Belong, So Good, and Lazy Baby. And those were all of her singles that she released between like The Girl and the Dreamcatcher and now. But she decided to reinvent herself, and in doing so, she took all of those old songs off of her like streaming services. So if you're like me, you still have a copy of them because they were bops. But I understand. Dove has been through so much in her life, which is part of why I just love her so much, because she is just this powerhouse of a person that has just faced down so much adversity and done it so well. She lost her father to suicide, unfortunately, when she was 15 years old. She obviously got engaged when she was 20, but realized that was way too young for her, and that relationship ended quite badly. And she said that it wasn't a good, healthy relationship for her to be in. And then unfortunately, a few years ago, her best friend, Cameron Boyce from Descendants, suddenly and tragically and unexpectedly passed away from an epileptic seizure that he had during the night. And obviously because he was in his bed, no one realized until the morning. And by then it was way too late to do anything about it, which I think has really been the catalyst for this major change in Dove's identity. Obviously, if you watched Disney back in the day, Dove was blonde. Now she is a very dark brunette. And her whole kind of style and her kind of persona has really changed ever since Cameron passed away. And I don't think it's necessarily, people say it's like she's dressing in black because she's grieving. I don't think it's necessarily that. I think it's just when you have something so seismic, so cataclysmic in your life, it can really change just the way that you see the world, the way that you are, you know, and to have such a great loss that's affected you so much. And, you know, since then, she was in a very intense relationship with Thomas Doherty, which then ended. She was on the West End, but then she suffered a back injury and had to go to hospital. And then people were really critical about that because they were like, I remember some guy went off at her on Twitter because he's like, my daughter wanted to see you in the West End and you didn't even like have the courtesy to be on stage. And she replied with a picture of the hospital bracelet she was wearing. She's like, I'm literally in the hospital. Like, she's just had a lot of shit thrown at her over the years. And I think all of that combined can just really affect just the way that you see the world. I know that when my friend passed away from cancer last year, it dramatically changed my outlook on life. And it is wild how just one incident like that can just completely change the way that you perceive everything. And so I think I can understand that she probably is a completely different person now than she was prior to that happening. And she was probably a different person after she lost her dad to who she was before she lost her dad. You know, these massive life events affect the way that you see the world. And so I can completely understand her wanting to, you know, take away that previous part of her life and say, like, I'm proud of what I created, because she said that. She's like, I still love my old music, but it's not who I am anymore. And I just want the world to see who I am now. And I want to make my music debut this way. Like, this is the me that I want to be the future. This is the me I want to present to the world. And I want to come out into the music industry like this. I don't want that old music to be the way that I'm viewed in the music industry. This is who I want to be in the music industry. And I can completely understand that. That said, Lazy Baby is still like one of my favorite songs she's ever done. And I will always sing the praises of Lazy Baby. And oh my God, she looked so good in that music video. That music video changed my brain chemistry. The other thing that I just really love about Dove, and I think why I relate to her so much now, even though I grew up with her, like I feel like I have a stronger like connection with her now because of her, the way that she talks about her identity. So Dove, she used to define herself as bi. I've seen recently she's defining herself now as pan, which fine. And I think that it's just, thing is, I mean, when I was younger, I used to look at her and just think she has such a queer energy about her as like a bisexual girl myself. But I was also in the closet. Like, I didn't know I was bi. But I suppose it was like the bi in me could see the bi in her, you know? Like, we can tell. Queer people can just sense queer people. We can sense each other's queer energy. And when she did eventually come out as bi, I was like, I knew it, I knew it. I could sense it in my soul. And she's so open now about her sexuality and her gender identity and how she doesn't, she is, you know, she uses like she, her pronouns, but she is quite happy to like experiment with her gender, like, what do you call it? Like, how you present your gender, you know, some days she's a bit more masculine, some days she's a bit more feminine. And I just love it. I just think she is so bold and and she's so smart and so in tune with the world. And I could just listen to her talk all day. And I just think she's wonderful. And I've rambled now for 8.5 minutes just talking about how much I love Dove Cameron. But I just felt like I needed to introduce this video by talking about like how much she means to me and how excited I am to finally get her albums. Because I feel such a deep connection with her as a person. And I feel like if we ever met, I feel like we would get on really well. I feel like we're on the same wavelength. But anyway, I'm really excited to get to hear the new songs. So for Alchemical Part 1, so Dove has released a variety of singles over the past few years, which are all leading up to Alchemical. But not all of the songs that she has released so far are on this half of the album, because this is Alchemical Volume 1. So we're going to have a Volume 2. So the songs that she's released, let's just have a look. The songs that she's released since she took everything Lazy Baby and before off of streaming are... Oh wow, Boyfriend only came out last year. I felt like that was at least like 3 years ago. Time hasn't been real since the pandemic. So she released Boyfriend, Breakfast, Bad Idea, Girl Like Me, We Go Down Together, Lethal Women, and now Sand. Sand just came out the other week there. So all of those songs on Alchemical Volume 1, we have Lethal Women, Breakfast, and Sand and Boyfriend. But Girl Like Me, We Go Down Together, and Bad Idea are on Volume 2, presumably. But we do have some new songs that we haven't heard before, which are Still, White Glove, God's Game, and Fragile Things. And Dove said in an interview that she really, really likes Fragile Things. So I'm so excited to finally get to hear that, because I know she really liked this song and she says it's really important to her. And I'm just so excited to finally get to hear it. But it's the last one on the album, so we'll be here a bit before I get to hear it. But I'm very excited. So obviously, I've been listening to Lethal Women, Breakfast, Sand, and Boyfriend over and over again since they released. So that will be a case of just bopping along, and then I will give you my thoughts on the new songs. So let's just get into it, shall we? Lethal Woman, I do want to say, one of the things I really love about Dove's music is because she is pansexual, like, her songs are about men or women. So, like, if you look at the track list for Alchemical, right, like, Lethal Woman and Boyfriend are about a woman that she was having a relationship with, or a romantic dalliance with, whereas Breakfast and Sand are about a boy, and I don't know who the other ones are about yet. And I just think that's so cool, because, like, as a bisexual woman, it is so fun to get to listen to an album where I can relate to, like, all of the songs. And, like, obviously I can relate to all songs anyway, because songs that are about men I relate to, songs that are about women I relate to. But just getting them all from one artist on one album is just a really fun experience for me. At least that's how I feel, you know, when you get to listen to it. And it just reflects how you feel, you know, where you're moving between, like, men and women, because that's just how my crushes work as well, you know, and how when I was single, I used to say that there were some days I would wake up in the morning and go, man, I wish I had a girlfriend. And other days I woke up and went, man, I wish I had a boyfriend. And it honestly just depended on the day of the week, whether I felt more in tune with women or men. And I think this album just is going to be really good to listen to as a bisexual person. But yeah, let's get into Lethal Woman. This song is, it's only 2 minutes and 7 seconds long, but my God, what it does with that 2 minutes and 7 seconds is just so good. Let's go. I love that song so much. Like, it's so short, but it's just so fun. It's so fun. Like, the first time I heard it, I was like, girl, and she'd done that, like, visualizer. And I was just like, I showed it to my boyfriend, because I was like, I was lying, like, next to him, and I was like, oh my God. And he's like, what? I'm like, you need to see this stuff come in visualizer, because, like, it's about to send me into a tailspin. And I showed it to him, and he was like, damn. And he's not even really into Dub Cameron. He was like, yeah, I can see where you're coming from. So it was just sitting there like, girl, she's so hot. And I always feel like, I feel like Dove dresses for the female gaze, you know what I mean? Like, she dresses in a way that all of the lesbians do be thirsting. Like, I can't explain it. It's just very, very gay. I think as well, like, I loved blonde Dove, right? Don't get me wrong. Like, she was so gorgeous when she was blonde. But then see, when she went goth, I was like, oh shit, she did that for me. Because, like, I am a girly that's out here, like, my big crushes, my big female celebrity crushes are, like, Angelina Jolie, love of my life, most beautiful woman that's ever graced the earth, Liz Gillies, Jodie Lynn O'Keefe, like, a lot of women who have that kind of very dark hair, pale skin, goth aesthetic. My goth girlfriends, my 3 weed-smoking goth girlfriends. So when she, like, turned, like, dark brunette goth and started wearing black all the time, I was like, oh. And I'm sitting here wearing black. I am wearing a yellow shirt, but I am wearing black. But that's mostly because it's freezing cold and this is the warmest jumper I own. It's -1 degrees outside, so. Anyway, so that was Lethal Woman, and next up we have Still. So I mean, I usually when I do these things, I like to try and guess what I think the song is going to be about, but what can I possibly guess about a song called Still? It's just still. Still as in not moving. Still as in like time, you know, like when, you know, we are still together, like the time frame of still, or what? I don't know. I don't know. I think it's going to be a ballad, because she did say that she was like, most of the songs she was releasing singles were like, kind of pop bangers, and she kept the ballads for the album because she was afraid of releasing a ballad. She said that about Sand. She was like, I'm really glad that Sand has been so well received because I was afraid of releasing a ballad, which is wild to me, because I've been sitting this whole time like, please release a ballad. Like, We Belong, We Go Down Together, I was just like, that was so good for me, because I love a sad ballad. I love a heartbreaking song, you know? And so I think Still's probably going to be a ballad. I think the songs that she hasn't released yet from this album are going to all be ballads, but I could be wrong. Happy to be proved wrong. But I don't know, the word still just seems like, when you think of still, you know, you think of stillness, things not moving. Like, people say that about like the winter, you know, when it's been snowing, you look outside and you say it's so still, because it just feels as if everything is stopped. You know, there's no one on the streets, the cars aren't moving, the ground is covered in snow, and you just think it's still. And so I feel like it's going to be a ballad. I feel like it's going to be about stillness. But I could click on this and it's going to be an absolute, like, party anthem. So we'll find out. Okay. This sounds like something that would be in like Metal Gear Solid. Like, I don't know how to explain it. It's got the sound of something that would be in a Hideo Kojima game. Like, I can picture this playing in Death Stranding while you're like running across the universe. Do you not think? I think so. I really like this chorus. We had a violin in there at the end. You know, I love a fiddle. That was really pretty. It also had like Kingdom Hearts vibes, but towards the end I was thinking like, this is reminding me of like Simple and Clean. I could picture this like also in a Kingdom Hearts game. I don't know, it just had real video game vibes to me. Like, I felt it had real video game vibes. It's really pretty though. I saw, there was a video yesterday that I watched. She was talking to, I can't remember what magazine it was, but a magazine, and she said that volume one of Alchemical is very much about a relationship that she came out of, which I assume is her relationship with Thomas. And she said it was about the moment of breaking up, but she said that moment lasted 2 years, which would make sense because I think it's been what, 2 or 3 years since she broke up with Thomas? It's been a while. Time didn't move, you know, time no longer exists. Ever since the pandemic, time has not quite moved in the way that we expect. But yeah, I'm assuming that this is also about it, because at the end there we have those lyrics of like, how dare you dare me to love you if you can't love me too, which kind of plays into what we hear later in the album in Sand, when she says, you know, that our love's misaligned because you're on my mind all the time. And you know, I don't have as much of you as you have of me, and we'll get there. yeah, really pretty, and as I expected, it was a ballad. If it had been a bop, I would have been very surprised. Okay, moving on from that, we now have Breakfast. Breakfast had the most wild music video, which was all about the patriarchy and misogyny, and it was fantastic. And she made a whole statement in the video about abortion rights, which was just so good, like, fantastic, absolutely, especially when you live in America, where they are just so, so backwards with all of their beliefs about reproductive health and reproductive rights and trying to take away our birth control. And, like, you know, they don't want you to get abortions, but they also don't want you to take birth control. And it's like... Because apparently you're just supposed to have like 50 children and raise them to be God's little soldiers, I suppose, is the thing. So she decided to use the Breakfast music video to make a statement about that, because it was right in the middle of the whole overturning Roe versus Wade debacle. So I thought that was iconic. And she did this whole thing where like she's meant to be like a man in business and like the man is the secretary, which, I mean, I know isn't a new idea, but like it worked so well in the video. It was so good. So let's listen to Breakfast. Breakfast is great. It's a bop. Let's have a listen. That intro. I love this intro so much. You smoke in my hair. Hot and dirty like the LA air. That face, baby, it ain't fair. But you don't know what you don't know what you don't know. Ooh, so you wanna talk about her?
Tried your best, and never said it's right. But I'm gonna keep doing it. I'm sick, yeah, I'm sick. And honestly, I'm getting high off it. Do you wanna see a magic trick? Cause you don't know what you don't know, but I know.
The laugh. I love the laugh. In my hair, hot and dirty like the LA air. That face, baby, it ain't fair. But you don't know what you don't know what you don't know. I eat boys like you for breakfast. One by one hung on my necklace. They'll always be mine. It makes me feel alive. I eat boys like you for breakfast. And I know that you tried your best things and never said it's right. But I'm gonna keep doing it. I eat boys like you for breakfast and I know that you tried your bestest is such a good lyric, because like I know bestest isn't a word, but it's just so fun. I love it. I know that you tried your bestest. It's so good. I mean, that's a lyric I would write, to be honest. I love it. Okay, what song is next? Oh, Sand. Okay, so, right. I need to do a quick jump over, because I decided when this song came out, right? I was like, I'm either going to be... I have two options here, right? Either I don't listen to the song at all for the next few weeks and wait until the full album comes out to do my reaction, or I record the reaction now and just edit it into the video later. So that's what I've done. So for Sand, we now head over to my past self from 2 weeks ago. Hey,
thanks, future me.
So as future me just said, or will say in like 3 weeks' time when I record it, when Dove released Sand, I was basically left with a choice of like, do I listen to it now and then miss getting to record my reaction, or do I wait until the album fully comes out and listen to it then, but then I'm weeks behind everyone else, and also I feel like I'm not supporting Dove and her single. And then I thought, actually, third option, just record your reaction now and edit it into the final video. So that's what we're gonna do, because Sand sounds like it's going to be a really powerful, really emotional song. It's also one of the longest songs we've had so far. A lot of the songs that we've had from Alchemical are like minus 3 minutes, but this one is actually 3 minutes 40. So a longer song, and it's a ballad. She said that it's a sad ballad, and the only sad song, or the only ballad we've had so far, is We Go Down Together, which isn't actually a sad song. Like, it's just a love song ballad. I forgot to mute my computer, be right back. So it's really the first kind of properly sad song that we've had on the album. And Dove said in a live stream recently that she was quite scared of doing ballads. She was really happy that Sand has been so well received. And I'm just really excited to hear it. She released a video in her broadcast channel about Sand and where the inspiration came from, and she said it was about a previous relationship that she was in, which was very intense and very all-consuming, but at the same time felt limited. And she said that when she finally got out of that relationship, she felt like she put so much of herself into it that she didn't know how to get that back, and she felt like she lost herself somewhere within that relationship. And she likened it to being held hostage in a place that you don't know, where you just can't find your way out and you can't find your way back to home. And she just felt like she couldn't find her way back to herself. And she said that it's only very recently that she's finally managed to kind of overcome that feeling. And she specifically said it's about a he. And obviously we know Dove's two major relationships with men have been her relationship with Ryan McCartan when she was 20 and they were engaged and then broke up, and then her relationship with Thomas Doherty, which was I think 4 years they were together, which she has described as being a very intense relationship. So I do wonder if it's about that. And she said, I remember she said that after she came out of that relationship she was very lost and that she just didn't really know what to do with herself. So I think there's a good chance that it's about her relationship with Thomas. I remember it was an interview she did on the release of Lazy Baby where she just said that she was very unsettled following that relationship. She just didn't know what to do with herself, and she was felt very lost and very confused and just very unwell following the breakup of that relationship. So I think there's a good chance that it's about that. But I'm very intrigued to hear it and to hear the lyrics and to really break it down and see what it's about. So, without further ado, let's hear Sand.
What's worse? Being wanted but no love. I loved but no wanted. What's worse? Hearing what you want to hear. We're hearing what's honest. Our love's misaligned.
I'm already so emotional. Oh wow, the production on it is like so beautiful and so heartbreaking, and she's managed to keep that very kind of synth goth sound even in a ballad, and I'm just, oh, I'm devastated. Okay, what's next? Like those vocals right there. Feel it in my soul. My phone was about to start playing Feather. That was devastating, but that is like the exact kind of music that I like. Like right at that ending there where it's like, you know, I have less pieces of you than I can hold in my hand. Like that is just so me. This is just such a me song. It's got that sort of ethereal, I want to say Celtic, it's not really, but like it's got that kind of ethereal quality that Celtic music quite often has that just speaks right to my soul. Like I feel it in my bones. But that is heartbreaking. She said in her video that it was based on a poem, and she said that in the poem the line was there are more grains of sand in the desert than I have thoughts of you, and there are less grains of sand in an hourglass than you think of me, or something like that. Basically saying that, like, you know, you have all of me, but I never had any of you. That I gave everything to this relationship and you gave nothing back. And I think there's a good chance that it is about her relationship with Thomas when you think about Lazy Baby, where she basically, don't know why you're waiting on me, if you don't work you don't eat, basically implying that he was never contributing. And I kind of assumed that it was like financially, basically being like, I'm out here doing all the work and earning all the money for us and you're doing nothing. But maybe she was being metaphorical. Maybe she was meaning like, I'm putting all of the work into this relationship and you're contributing nothing. Like, you are lazy in this relationship. Like, emotionally you're not putting enough effort in, and I'm doing everything to hold this relationship together and you're doing nothing. But yeah, that broke my heart. That was beautiful. That was an absolutely fantastic song. That could be the best song she's done so far. but we still have a whole bunch of songs I haven't heard yet. So we'll find out when the album comes out on December 1st and when this video goes up. Weeks from now. Okay, back to the future. And we're back to the present. I have to say though, like, I've been listening to Sand non-stop since it came out and I just love it so much. And I've also, I don't know what it is, right? But there's something about this song, I think it's because I did say, like, in that bit there that it has a bit of a kind of folk, not folk, but like, there's something about it that feels very fantasy, very dark fantasy vibes, right? And it just makes me want to sing it in a Scottish accent. So every time I've been singing along to the song, and I don't generally sing in a Scottish accent, I generally sing in the accent of the song that I'm singing, right? Like, you know what I mean? Like, if I'm singing a song by, like, an American, I'll be singing it in, like, the closest thing to an American accent. But, like, there's just something about this movie want to sing it Scottish. So I've just been like, you have more pieces of me than the desert has sand. And I have less pieces of you than I can hold in my hand. And I just think, like, it would sound so good as, like, a Scottish, like, a folk Scottish Celtic song. I can't really describe it. I don't know. I think it would work really well. If I could play instruments, I would record it, but I can't play any instruments. So I've got no, I can only sing it. I've got no instrumentation. But anyway, what song is next? White Glove. So White Glove is interesting because I'm like, what could that possibly mean? I mean, you say white glove to me and I think of Michael Jackson with the white glove, but I don't think it's going to be a song about Michael Jackson. I mean, maybe it is, but I kind of doubt it. It also makes me think of, like, you know, like flower, like foxglove. A foxglove isn't white. Is a foxglove white? Or maybe it's something else entirely. Do you think it's like the scarf that Taylor Swift left in the drawer? Is this like a glove that Dove left in someone's house? I don't know, but white again makes me think of purity, you know, white like snow, white like when you clean your clothes with Persil. So I feel like it's going to be a ballad.
Honey, you've got a big storm coming.
But again, I don't know. We will find out. I have to say, on Instagram this morning, I did see a lot of people talking about White Glove. I saw a lot of people saying that this was their favourite on the album, so I am very intrigued to hear what this is. Oh. Let's talk about love. She played a bit of this on one of her stories or a TikTok or something. I had no idea that was this song. This is not what I expected at all. I did not think that this was the song that came from. Okay, let's go. Let's start again because I was completely taken aback by that. Hang on. Oh, I love this. This is so good. Slippery slope, a heavy dose of heaven knows. She stayed at home, so it took Maddie with a hand of clothes. She's soprano, the way she hit that icy note. But I guess that's how it goes. Snow on the floor, honey, I can't see straight. Hands on the door, trying to break it. Earthquake, pour on the floor, make the whole house shake. Who are these friends anyway? Let's talk about love. Let's talk about this. Sex, money, and drugs. Like pick a delice. Everything like love. Everything's like crazy. my god. I just noticed right there at the end she'd put in the tune to Lethal Woman right in those last few seconds. I don't know if you can hear it. That's not what I was expecting at all. I thought that was going to be a ballad. That was probably the hardest song on the whole album. That one, that goes hard and it slaps. Oh my god. Thing is, I couldn't actually make out like almost a word she was saying. So when we do get the lyrics for that, I am going to have to sit and analyze them because like vibes are immaculate. Do not have a clue what she just said. Didn't. I heard the words earthquake, something about hands shaking. No, something shaking and then said, who needs hands anyway? That was about all I made out of the entire song. I can understand why people said that was their favorite one off the album because that is wild. That is just so not what I was expecting. It's so funny, like I said, like we have heard part of that song before. I just did not know that that's what it was. I was not expecting White Glove to be that song. Oh, we do have the lyrics, hang on. Oh, it was who needs friends anyway, not hands, oh my god. Snow on the floor, honey, I can't see straight. Hands in the door, trying to break in, earthquake. Pour on the floor, make the whole house shake. Who needs friends anyway? Let's talk about love, let's talk about this. Sex, money and drugs, flick flick of the wrist. Everything White Glove, everything sang quick. Got the Midas touch, fuck you think this is. Wow, okay, so big sexy number. Yeah, that was incredible. I am going to need time to digest it. Okay, so up next, number 6 on the album, we have God's Game. So interesting one, because that really could be about anything. Like, I mean, God's game, I suppose, is our lives, isn't it? You know, the game that God plays with our lives. Fate, destiny, you know, the idea, you know, people who believe in a God or gods, you know, believe that God puts you on a path, that he defines your life for you, that he has a plan for you, that he, or she, you know, works in mysterious ways but ultimately brings you to where you need to be in life. So is it about that, or is it maybe a sad song about like about being a pawn in God's game, like the idea that like God is like a chess master and that ultimately he just moves the pawns around and we all just have to deal with what he decides for us? Is it maybe about the pain of losing the people in her life, like her dad and Cameron, you know, the idea that that's all just part of God's plan, but it ultimately just makes everyone's lives more sad? Or is it maybe about someone with a God complex and the games that they play in relationships, you know, like someone who thinks that they're God and then uses your emotions like it's a game? I don't know. It could be anything. What did I say? That maybe it's about a partner and saying that he's got a God complex and that he's playing God's game. I got it right. I nailed it. It's just a boy with a man's face playing God's game. Girl, she just fucking read him for filth. Jesus Christ. Let's go. Everyone but me, been alchemical ever since 15.
scared, always running, never stunning. I'm desperate for my delusions, not much of a solution. Never knowing what the truth is. Oh God. How in my life would you lie?
I love this. I love this. I love that. Oh my God. What did I say? That is like so scathing. Like, you only want to hurt me so you can be my saving grace. Just a boy with a man's face playing God's game. Girl, fucking read him. Now don't get me wrong, like, I loved Thomas Doherty since he was in Disney's bizarre musical mystery drama series The Lodge. Right, The Lodge is truly one of the worst TV shows I've ever seen, and I raced home from university every Friday to see it. Like, truly just a terrible program, and I ate that shit up. Like, this is unfortunately just who I am. I sat through all 7 seasons of Riverdale, and I've seen every episode of The Lodge. It's just who I am as a person. But like, I've loved him ever since The Lodge. And I don't have anything against him. I don't know what happened in his relationship with Dove. But clearly, from the way that she's talking, she just feels that he was not... She's always described this relationship as very intense. She was, like, fully invested in this relationship. Like, her whole heart and soul into this relationship. And she just didn't feel like she was getting the same back from him. And she has made this comment before, because, like, in Lazy Baby, she says, like, promised you would fuck up my life. And then here we've got, like, you only hurt me so you can be my saving grace. It sounds as if there was something a bit toxic going on there about just his kind of influence over her life. But, like I say, we don't know. We don't know. And she's never really spoken out. It is very much just figuring out what we can from the lyrics. But it does sound as if their relationship went very, very wrong. Which is a real shame, because when they were together, they seemed like they were the perfect couple, you know? Like, to the outside world, they looked perfect. But as we all know, just because something, you know, you don't show the bad parts of your relationship on Instagram. You know, you put up the pretty pictures. You don't put up the pictures of when you're fighting and you're you know, arguing, or you're having, you know, you're storming out of the house or whatever. Like, you don't show those parts of a relationship to the world. So they looked really perfect together. But clearly there was something deeply wrong under the surface. And as Dove said, you know, it took her like 2 years to go over that, which just goes to show that that must have really had an impact on her, if it's taken that long just to try and process the fallout from that. Well, next up we have Boyfriend, which was the first single she released in the brunette era, when she went brunette and turned goth and reinvented herself. This was the first single she came out with, and it is so iconic. Dove said that this song was about when she was at, the story in the song is true, that she was at a club or a bar or whatever, and there was a girl hanging about on her own, and Dove really thought she was hot, so she just went up to her and stole her away from her boyfriend. The girl's boyfriend wasn't paying her any attention, so Dove did, and according to Dove, they went back to a hotel room and slept together, so... Good for her. Good for both of them, honestly. I mean, what the dream. I shouldn't say that online. Anyway, but this was incredible. And the first time I heard the line, plus all my clothes would fit, I almost, like, died on the spot. This song is everything. Let's have a sing-along, shall we? Oh, it still gets me. I love this so much.
I can't believe we're finally alone. went home. What are the chances? Everyone's dancing, and he's not with you. The universe must have defined this. What am I gonna do? Not grab your wrist.
Honestly, first time I heard this, I lost my mind.
Tell you twice all the ways you can't suffice. If I could give you some advice, I would leave with me tonight. Must have to find the ladies first, baby. I am sick. I never would have left you alone. Here on your own, go to your phone. I would have left you. Someone else to take you home. I could be a better boyfriend than him. I could do the shit that he never did. Up all night, I won't quit. I'm gonna steal you from him. I could be such a gentleman. Plus, you know my clothes will fit.
Honestly, like, the first time I heard that, it was just like, I was just so not prepared for it. I mean, a song called Boyfriend, you know? I think that was the thing. The fact that it was called Boyfriend, I assumed it was going to be a song about a boyfriend, you know what I mean? Like, I did not expect it to be a song about a girl, and I definitely did not expect the idea of the song to be, I could be a better boyfriend than your boyfriend. I can be such a gentleman, plus all my clothes would fit. And she said that it was partly inspired by, like, I mean, obviously it's a true story, but, like, she also said, there's a really funny video, I think it's genius, where she's, like, talking about her friends, and she's, like, saying how her friends are just always going on, it's like, oh, he's so mean to me, he never pays me any attention, he never spends time with me, and she's,
like, growing up queer, like, listening to my peer girls be like, why won't he just, he never, and, like, he meant my birthday, he forgets my mom, he never speaks to my friend, like, and it was, like, basic shit, where I was, like, babes, you don't need a fucking handbook to get this right. Like, it was making me feel like I was on a different planet listening to these women speak about how poorly they were just little things that are obvious boyfriend things. I was like, I could do boyfriend better. It's not difficult.
Like, and then she was like, she said to her friends, like, I could be a better boyfriend than that. And that was kind of where it came from, was this idea of, like, boys in relationships can be so trash. And she's like, you should just date girls because I could be a better boyfriend than him. And it's just so iconic. Okay, and finally we get to the song I'm so excited to hear. I've been waiting so long to hear it. It is Fragile Things. Dove said she was doing a live on Insta with Matt XIV. That is the right number, right? Him, Matt. You know Matt. Everyone knows Matt. And she was in a live with him, and someone had asked, like, what song are you, like, most excited about, and, like, what song do you like the production of most, or something like that. And she said, like, Fragile Things. And she said it's a song, and she said, what was it she said? She said it's a song, it's about something that she hasn't really spoken about, or, like, sung, like, she hasn't written, spoken about in her music, she hasn't written a song about before. And she said to Matt, she goes, you know what it's about. But she didn't say to us on the live what it's about. So I'm really excited to hear what this is and to try and listen to the lyrics and pick out what it's about. The title makes me think, it's not going to be about this, but, like, the title makes me think of the Depeche Mode song Precious, because the opening line of that song is precious and fragile things need special handling, my God, what have we done to you? Which is a song that the songwriter wrote, I can't remember which member of Depeche Mode it was, wrote about his divorce from his wife and about the impact it had on his children, which is, like, what that means, like, precious and fragile things need special handling, my God, what have we done to you? We always tried to share the tenderest of care, now look what we have put you through. things get damaged, things get broken. I thought we'd managed, but words left unspoken left us so brittle, there was so little left to give. It's a great song, you should listen to it. But every time I read Fragile Things, that's what I think of. But I don't know what Dove sees as a fragile thing. Life? Love? Your mental health? It could be any of them. And she struggled in all of those aspects, you know, losing people, people dying. She's had many struggles with her mental health, which she is incredibly open about on her social media. Her love life has been a bit fractured over the years. So any of those things could be fragile. And I'm just really excited to get to find out what this song's about. So let's have a listen.
TV was on, the foundation's here, but the magic is gone. I let you in, but you let it all decay. The lights are burnt out, the flowers are dead. Somehow I'm still supposed to sleep in this bed. Gave you a key, but I couldn't make you stay. But I'm still glad you came to visit. Love is like a house of fragile things, where hearts can be broken as easy as it takes. And now there's glass all shattered.
So again, it's about how I was trying to decide what the fragile thing is. It was her love, and the relationship that she had with Thomas was obviously a house of cards ready to fall down, essentially, is what she's saying. Something about this is giving me Schmigadoon, you know? It reminds me of the kind of music she sang in Schmigadoon.
Watching me sleep, dancing on your feet always. I'll replace the flaws, whatever I do. The ghost of you will always live in these rooms. You get to leave, I don't have that luxury. But I'm still glad you came to.
I was not expecting that ending there where this music goes all garbled. It was honestly making me think of that song from Madison that I hate so much. Bloody, what is his name? Blue Knees. I hate that song so much. Not this song, the song from Madison. That was really pretty. I need the lyrics. I need the lyrics. The door was unlocked, the TV was on, the foundation's here, but the magic is gone. I let you in, then you let it all decay. The lights are burned down, the flowers are dead. Somehow I'm still supposed to sleep in this bed. Gave you a key, but I couldn't make you stay. But I'm still glad you came to visit. Love is like a house of fragile things, where hearts can be broken as easy as antiques. And now there's glass shattered at my feet. What we built together, you left in smithereens. I thought she said memories, smithereens. That word always makes you think of makes me think of Dexter's laboratory. He blows his experiments to smithereens. I paint all the walls a fresh coat of blue, but I'll never cover the memory of you watching me sleep, dancing on your feet always. I'll replace the floors. Whatever I do, the ghost of you will always live in these rooms. You get to leave, but I don't have that luxury. But I'm still glad you came to visit. So basically about what it's like to live in the house that you lived in with your partner after you've broken up, and kind of being like, there's nothing I can do to get your memory out of this house. Remember looking at this room, we loved it because of the light. Now I just sit in the dark and wonder if it's time. That kind of thing. Oh, that's so sad. But at the same time saying like, I'm so glad you came to visit. So like, even though I'm really upset about what's happened between us and it's had a, you know, really negative effect on my life and I'm miserable, I'm still glad that we had that relationship, even if I'm not, even if it didn't work out for us. Which is a nice way to round out the album, because obviously she said that the volume one of Alchemical was very much about that relationship. So to kind of go on that journey and end it with like, I'll never be able to get the memory of you out of my head, but I'm still glad that we had this relationship, even though it didn't work out and I may be worse off for it, I'm still glad that it happened. Better to have loved and lost than to have never loved at all, as they say. Okay, well that was Alchemical. I think, what is my favourite? Because like, of all the songs that she's released so far, I've kind of always said that Bad Idea was my favourite. I really like Bad Idea. But it's on volume two. So in terms of Alchemical, just pulling it back up because I was on Genius there. I think of the eight songs we have in Alchemical, it's between Sand and White Glove. I really liked White Glove, but I absolutely adore Sand. Like, I've listened to Sand so many times since it came out. I just think it's gorgeous. And that music video she just released, stunning. Hang it in the Louvre. But White Glove, everyone on Instagram was writing that as an absolute bop. So I think for me, it's between Sand and White Glove. But honestly, all of the new songs have been great. All of the songs she had were great. She has never released a bad song. It is just incredible. Her mind, her talent. But yeah, I'm off to listen to White Glove another 20 times, as well as all of the other new songs off the album, and just play it on repeat and give Dove the streams, because we love to support women, women supporting women. And yeah. That's really all I have for today. I hope you've enjoyed coming on this journey through Alchemical Volume 1 with me. And I will catch you in what I post next, which will very hopefully be a video about Hornblower. It's in the works. So hopefully that will be the next thing you see from me. But I will see you then. Bye everyone.